Welcome to our time of worship again. On Wednesday, it was great to be able to preach at Corridrea, actually seeing and interacting with the people. We know that God is with us regardless of the circumstances in which we worship together. And so we know that God is here, even though we are at distances from one another. I would like to read, first of all, this morning from Isaiah and chapter 60, verses 1 to 3, and then verses 18 through 20. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. No longer will violence be heard in your land, nor ruin or destruction within your borders. But you will call your walls salvation, and your gates praise. The sun will no more be your light by day, nor will the brightness of the moon shine on you. For the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Your sun will never set again, and your moon will wane no more. The Lord will be your everlasting light, and your days of sorrow will end. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for light. Lord, we all appreciate how light helps us. As we are helped by natural light, the sun, the moon, the stars, and the light of your word, may we be lights in our dark world. Help us daily to reflect your glory. Father, we are privileged to share in your awesome presence, and we go out into the world knowing that our lives can tell your story. Amen. We also turn in the scripture to Matthew and chapter 5. And we're going to read the well-known verses from verses 14 through 16. I think many people know that Matthew chapter 5 is the chapter in which we find the Beatitudes, the blessings that God will have, wants to have us enjoy. And part of our enjoyment is to be able to share something of that which we receive from God. So Jesus said in Matthew 5 from verse 13, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." We sing together the hymn, "Lord, the light of your light is shining." I think that we are all familiar with a candle. A candle has two parts. It has a wick and it has wax. The two cannot work effectively apart from one another. They have to be one thing. If you were to heat the wax, you would not get light. You could take a wick by itself, just a piece of string. You could burn it, and it would not last a matter of seconds. They need to be together to be effective. People are like candles. They also have two parts, body and soul. The body cannot work without the soul, and the soul cannot exist without a body. That is just the way that God has created us. That is true not only for our present living, but it is true into eternity. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I encourage you to go and read these verses, verses 35 and 36, and then verses 42 to 44, we have clear guidance with regard to the fact that when a person dies, a person receives a new body. There is no separation between body and soul. The body is changed, but the soul remains always with a body. When we were created from the beginning of time, it was clear that God intended for body and soul to be one. In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, Moses says, "The Lord God, Yahweh Elohim, formed a person, Adam, from the dust of the ground, Adama." The word Adam comes from the Hebrew Adama, ground. Often it is said at a funeral, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. I do not think that that is a fitting end to a funeral, in that God is clear that although, yes, the body we have now returns to Adama, back to ground, we are given a new body and we become a new person when we die. We cannot separate body and soul. And so, after making this body from ground, the second half of the verse says, God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the person became a living soul, nefesh. And so, people are created two parts. The one cannot work or exist without the other. Let's go back to our candle. The purpose of a candle is to create light. In order for it to fulfill its purpose, a candle needs to be lit. For a person to serve their purpose, the person also, as it were, like a candle, needs to be lit. John calls this lighting of the candle or the person born of God. Seven times this phrase is used in John's first letter. To serve our purpose in life, we need to be born of God. Now, once the candle has been lit, there are two important things that must happen to the candle to keep it effective. Number one, it must be kept upright. This becomes dangerous and more ineffective. A candle at an angle is dangerous not only to itself, it burns a lot quicker, and of course it is dangerous to other people. We too, as people, need to be kept upright. And that is why we have the Word of God, to help us to, in our lives, be kept upright. The second challenge of being candle is that the candle be kept in the open. Jesus explains the importance of a light being put on a stand, as we have already read in Matthew 5 and 15. In the next verse, Jesus likens the candle on its stand to letting your light shine before others. God wants for us as his people to shine in a dark world. Children, enjoy the chorus, "This Little Light of Mine." This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Shine it all over Winterberg, I'm going to let it shine. Shine it below the Winterberg, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. For our offering this week, I would like for us to offer our quote-unquote testimony to our Father. Now, what do I mean by that? Testimony is simply a public communication of what God has done for you personally. In Acts chapter 26, Paul shares his testimony as to how God changed his life in a courtroom. For our offering today, we reaffirm a willingness to openly share, as God gives us opportunity, how he has and continues to change our lives, bring to us blessing, things that other people need to know God is doing for his children. Let's pray. Father, we, as it were, give back to you our many blessings for the specific task of fulfilling what Jesus asked us to pray. Thy kingdom come. Amen. We sing together the hymn, "There's a Call Comes Ringing O'er the Restless Waves."
There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless waves.
Send the light,
send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save.
Send the light,
send the light, send the light. We will spread,
we will spread the everlasting light.
With a
wind, with a wind,
leading wind,
heart and hand.
Give
His command.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light.
Let it
shine from shore to shore.
Send
the light, and let its radiant beams
light the world.
Light the world.
The hymn that we have sung is based on the theme of our worship, light, and God's call to Paul to take the gospel to Macedonia. A well-known city of Macedonia that Paul ministered to and spent time in jail at was Philippi. This story of God's call for Paul to go to Macedonia is found in Acts 16, verses 6 through 10. Paul, as a light to the Philippians, encouraged them to shine like stars in a warped and crooked generation. Philippians 2:15. Has the church's role changed in any way today? Once again, an underpinning practice of God's people in any missionary endeavor is the communion service. At the end of his outline of the communion service in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26, Paul says, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim or send out the message, the gospel, until Jesus comes." The communion service is in itself a quote-unquote testimony of God's multifaceted blessings. To that end, we share together again this morning around Jesus' table. The world is God's goal. Behind me you see a map of the world with a candle burning. In a unique way, COVID-19 has made the world smaller. Our prayer today for the world for which Jesus died. And so we remember together that Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, broke it, and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we take of the bread and we eat it with thanksgiving. Our Father, we thank you again for that wonderful verse, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. As we break bread together, we think of a world in need for which Jesus died. Amen. After they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant. Drink this in remembrance of me." And so we drink together. Our Father, we thank you again for the new covenant of which we are such an important part and such a blessed part. We ask, Father, that we will take to heart again the challenge that Jesus gave to us to be lights to the world. And so as we come to the end of our worship, we acknowledge again all that Jesus has done for us. We thank you that we can sing of it as we close our worship this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our final hymn, to the glory of God.
All the pain things.
Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.